Into 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 FM in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org. Stay tuned for About Health.
Good afternoon, and welcome to About Health. Good afternoon, and welcome to About Health. I'm so glad you could join us. Is the place you work in safe from harm? Do you feel secure that your work environment, the job you do, or the products you work with won't hurt you? Perhaps you've never asked yourself these questions, but we should. All of us should. And consider these really staggering statistics. Each day in the United States, 13 people die from work-related injuries. Over 7,500 people are injured on the job. Over 400 people suffer work-related illnesses. And another 150 people die from chronic occupational diseases. Now, when you add up all of these figures, it amounts to over 8,000 people each day in the U.S. whose health and well-being is significantly affected by their work. The most dangerous jobs are in construction, transportation, agriculture, and mining. Also at increased risks are nursing assistants, police, firefighters, janitors, and cleaners. And risks differ among various populations. Latinos are at higher risk of death than other workers, and nearly 7 out of 10 Latinos killed are immigrants. Workers age 55 or older are also at increased risk. Now, as staggering as labor statistics are, they are based only on those incidents that are reported. Many, many go unreported. According to one analysis presented to Congress, workers may suffer 3 times as many injuries and illnesses as official data indicate. Now, it's important to point out that most workplace injuries and illnesses are preventable. And strong regulations play a big part in prevention. But the current political climate has many worried about the future of worker protections. The Obama administration had a strong track record on worker health and safety, including strengthening enforcement and issuing key safety and health standards. The Trump administration and Republican Congress, on the other hand, have launched a major assault on worker protections by aggressively rolling back safety regulations and blocking new protections. Today is International Workers Day, also known as May Day. On About Health today, we're going to commemorate the occasion and our nation's workforce by discussing workers' health and safety. I'm Dr. Will Courtney, the men's doc, a psychotherapist in Oakland, and your host. Joining me in studio to talk about workers' health and safety are two guests who both know a lot about the subject. Laura Stock is the director of the Labor Occupational Health Program at the University of California, Berkeley. The program educates and empowers workers and communities to take an active role in making workplaces safe, healthy, dignified, and just. Ms. Stock received her Master of Public Health from UC Berkeley and has been working in the field of occupational health for over 30 years. Ms. Stock is also a member of the Cal-OSHA Standards Board, which is charged with developing effective workplace health and safety standards for the state. Laura Stock, welcome to About Health.
Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure to have you. Garrett Brown is also joining us. He is an occupational health and safety professional and a certified industrial hygienist. He, too, received his Master of Public Health from UC Berkeley. Mr. Brown recently retired from Cal-OSHA, where he was a field compliance officer conducting workplace health and safety inspections for 18 years. In addition to his local work, Garrett Brown has coordinated workplace health and safety projects around the world. Garrett Brown, thank you for joining us on About Health.
A pleasure to be here.
So, Laura Stock, I'd like to begin with you. When most people think about their health, they think about things like what they're eating or how they're exercising. But the fact is, most people spend the majority of their days at work. And most people don't even think about how their work responsibilities or work environment is affecting their health or what they should be doing to protect themselves. So how should we be thinking differently about workplace safety? And what are we missing here in terms of the risks we face?
Well, As you say, work is one of the biggest determinants of health status. And as you say, it's where we spend over half of our working hours. And the terrible statistics you mentioned in your introduction result from millions of workers being exposed every day to hazards on the job. And a few examples of that, as you say, you know, there are hazards in every job. It's easy to think it's a job that's not related to the job that we all do, like a miner or construction worker, though there are many construction workers who might be listening. But it's good to recognize that in every job, there are hazards to be found. You could be working in an office all day and exposed to ergonomic hazards. You could be working in a restaurant and injured by slips and falls. You could be working in a hospital and exposed to needle sticks or hazardous chemicals. And in many of these and other jobs, you could be exposed to high levels of workplace stress caused by excessive workload, unpredictable schedules, and poor supervision. And the tragedy of this is that, as you say, these illnesses and injuries are preventable. And in fact, employers in California are required by law to ensure that their workplace, that every workplace is safe, which includes having a plan for how they're going to identify and correct hazards, provide training, ensuring that workers can report without fear of retaliation, providing workers compensation if they get injured on the job. No one should have to risk their health at work. So I know what we've been talking about at LOHP is just trying to promote and advocate for a new vision of what work should be, something that we called healthy jobs, and that every job should have living wages, freedom from hazards, reasonable workloads, freedom from harassment on the job, job security, dignity and respect, benefits, et cetera. So these are the kinds of new ways we need to be thinking about work and the kind of conditions that we all are should be entitled to.
Mm-hmm. And it just doesn't get enough attention, does it?
Right. I think it's great that you're doing this show, and I think that it's really not something that's at the forefront of people's minds. And also, I think it's because people, when they get sick, there's often a tendency to try to look for individual behaviors or things that people are doing wrong that cause their illness, that they're not eating right, they're not exercising, and not looking at the sort of structural or objective conditions that they live and work under that contribute to their health status.
Uh-huh. So doctors then probably don't ask a lot about...
Yeah, I mean, this is another big problem that a lot of people are trying to figure out how to tackle, which is that most primary care doctors get very little training on occupational health. And it's, you know, a lot of people are working to try to at least institute that a essential first question is, what do you do for work, so that people can begin to make the link between the symptoms that people are presenting with or the health problems they have and the work that they do.
Uh-huh. Well, thank you for that, Laura. And Garrett Brown, you've worked with Cal OSHA for years and have conducted workplace health and safety inspections throughout the Bay Area. If you would describe for us some of the unique health and safety concerns of our region.
Well, in the Bay Area, some things are similar to the rest of the country. There's a lot of construction that's taking place, especially in San Francisco these days, and transportation, which are the two big national issues where people are suffer a lot of injuries and illnesses. In the Bay Area in particular, I would say that there's four professions that we have a lot of people working in. First is healthcare. That's one of the largest economic sectors of the country as a whole, and also very large in the Bay Area. And as Laura mentioned, there's a number of hazards associated with work in healthcare, be it a hospital or a nursing home or the like, including infectious diseases, bloodborne pathogens. Unfortunately, workplace violence is a big issue in many healthcare facilities these days. The second area is the hospitality industry, hotels, restaurants. Hazards associated with all of this. There's a new standard being proposed that Laura will be hearing about even more this year on housekeepers and hotels having protections against the ergonomic hazards they face on the job. Restaurant workers, of course, have chemical exposures depending on their job and high levels of noise. Also in the Bay Area are laboratories, chemical laboratories, research laboratories, which have, again, hazards related to chemical exposures and to ergonomics. repetitive motions in their jobs. And then lastly, office work. There's a lot of office work in the Bay Area. And again, some of the hazards associated with that are ergonomics or the lack of having work stations that fit the worker rather than the other way around. Slip, trips, and falls are a problem, and often, depending on the building, life safety issues in terms of getting out in the event of an earthquake, which we're going to have at some point or another, and fires and the like.
Mm-hmm. Well, thanks for that overview. And I like that workstations that fit the worker and not the other way around. And I expect we will be hearing from some of these workers out there and at their desks, perhaps. And if you're just joining us, you are listening to About Health. I'm Dr. Will Courtney, your host. Today on International Workers' Day, May Day, we're talking about occupational health and safety. And we are going to want to hear from you. Our number is 510-848-4425. That's 8-4-8-4-4-2-5. Toll free, the number is 1-800-958-9008. 1-800-958-9008. We want to hear from you about your work environment and any health risks you face or safety standards you're worried about. If you've been one of the over 7,000 people who are injured on the job each day, please give us a call and tell us what happened. We'll be taking your calls shortly. Again, our numbers are 1-800-958-9008 or 510-848-4425. So, you know, the Bay Area is the hub of the tech industry of the state, and many people don't realize that the industry also hires large number of low-wage workers who are cleaning or in the kitchens or driving. Are there particular health or safety risks these workers face?
Well, workers driving buses for the Google buses up and down the peninsula, or restaurant workers working in the free restaurants at Google or Apple or Amazon face really the same hazards they do anybody does in a restaurant or transportation. One of the issues there, though, is that one of the problems in today's economy is that there's an increased number of people outsourced. That is, that they're not working for Google, they're not working for Apple, they're working for a service company.
The gig economy.
The gig. Well, it's yeah. Oftentimes, the gig economy you might think of as, you know, young hipster tech people who go to work in front of their laptop. Another part of the gig economy is, as you suggest, people that are working for subcontractors, and those are people generally that paid much lower wages, oftentimes without any benefits, and with employers who either don't know what their obligations are under the law or, frankly, are trying to minimize the expenses to comply with those laws. So oftentimes people who are working for temporary agencies, staffing agencies, health agencies, help agencies are people that do not get the required training or not provided the required protective equipment and are not considered to be part of the workforce, even though both for Cal OSHA and for the law they are.
Mm-hmm. So when you were mentioning you had mentioned earlier trips and falls, and then when you said restaurants, I'm presuming that's probably often an issue in kitchens or in restaurants, trips and falls. Is that?
That's one of the hazards, mm-hmm. certainly. Mm-hmm. And there are also a lot in office environments, believe it or not. There, the number of people that fall downstairs in an office environment is actually quite large, and people get injured if you fall downstairs.
Uh-huh.
It's important, slips and falls and having, well-lit and properly a signage on ways to leave the building and stuff are very important.
Mm-hmm.
And just one thing to add, when we talk about those low-wage workers that are working in Silicon Valley and in other places around the Bay Area and the country, is that, and as you said early on, many of them are immigrant workers. And so, you know, the statistics have been showing that immigrant workers do die at a greater rate than other workers. And a lot of it is because they're working in hazardous jobs, more hazardous jobs, and they don't have training in their own language, and they But a big issue that they face is fear of retaliation. And often
reporting.
People, mm-hmm. and so that results both in lower statistics, as you mentioned. That means that they're probably underreported the number of injuries, but it makes it much more difficult for them to take action. Often those workers are working in non-union places where they don't have the protection of a union to help, you know, collect their voices and mm-hmm. present that to their employer. And this fear of retaliation and being in a particular vulnerable working environment, if you're an immigrant or if you're undocumented, or you're low wage, where you're living paycheck to paycheck, it's much more risky to be able to step forward as an individual to try to demand change. So all of those kinds of conditions in these low wage tech jobs and other places are why, you know, such workers are at higher risk than mm-hmm. others. And I just wanted to mention also that you said that older workers get injured at a higher rate. I want to mention that younger workers also get injured at a higher rate.
Yeah.
Young workers who are new in the job and are also afraid to speak up for the same kinds of reasons often don't have adequate training. And I'm glad to have an opportunity to mention it today because actually May has been designated by the governor as Safe Jobs for Youth Month. And that's a month where there's a lot of efforts going on statewide to try to raise awareness among young workers and among employers about how to protect rights on the job. And we have a campaign at LOHP, which you can find out more about it going to youngworkers.org. But I did want to say that young mm-hmm. workers are also at greater risk than the general public. Mm-hmm.
And so what's planned around this month?
So there's a lot of different things that are planned. We have there's a leadership academy where we bring teams of youth from around the state to plan events in their own communities, such as working to try to do training around in high schools around work permits or getting media around workers' rights for youth. There's a poster contest which youth from around the state participate in. There's a video conference. And actually, we're excited that this year Senator Pan introduced a resolution in support of Safe Jobs for Youth Month and have laid out something that will form the basis of a Young Worker Bill of Rights. You can find out more information about that on the website.
Great. That's good to know about. Well, you know, we've already got some callers calling in here because this is a great topic, and I'm looking forward to hearing from them. So why don't we go to Leslie right now in Oakland, and welcome to About Health, Leslie.
Hi, thank you very much. This is Leslie Landberg in downtown Oakland, and I have been environmentally disabled all of my life, and as it has not come up yet as a topic in our discussion yet, I thought I should highlight for you that it is a very important and very little recognized hazard, particularly, I think, in office environments. I used to regularly pass out, and I was tagged as being a malingerer, but the fact of the matter is that there is a tremendous amount of CFLs and fluorocarbons and off-gassing from formaldehyde, from upholstery. There's also these natural cleaning products that everybody seems to try to want to use.
Uh-huh.
They're terribly hazardous, and they're in some cases worse than the products that they're meant to replace. But bringing it to the attention of people who manage the workplaces, you just get a stone wall. And even talking to other employees, as if they're not very sensitive to these things, they don't realize that they can cause cancer and endocrine disruption and just all kinds of horrendous things that, you know, it's a smoking gun that people don't recognize.
Mm-hmm. I'm so glad you called, Leslie. And what's just give us a little bit better idea sort of where you are working. Like, what size office are we talking about? And is it what type of office were you working in?
Okay, that's an excellent question. This issue can be in a very tiny sole proprietorship or in a very, very large environment. And so it really doesn't matter the size. I was a secretary, an executive secretary, so I would find myself working for sole proprietors or for large corporations. But right across the board, it's been a consistent problem, environmental toxicity, very big problem. And it's unrecognized because a lot of people's immune systems are much healthier than mine was. I was born with selective IgA deficiency, which a lot of people don't realize that they have. That makes you a lot more susceptible. But even though people have a stronger immune system and they don't recognize the danger, they're all in great danger.
Mm-hmm. So, and it sounds like your employers were pretty unresponsive to your expressed concerns.
It was ridiculous, the level of dismissiveness. I would send them all kinds of websites and studies and, you know, things to back up my contentions, so I just wasn't trying to foment dissent. I was trying to alert people as to the dangers and how easily these could be corrected.
Mm-hmm. Really. And educate them, it sounds like. So, yeah, Garrett, do you want to address what Leslie is talking about?
Yeah, I mean, it's getting increasingly known. I would agree. It's not been something that the occupational health profession has been able to really wrap their arms around in terms of individuals with high levels of chemical sensitivities. One thing to point out is that we do have regulations related to chemical exposures of various kinds of chemicals, but they're sort of designed to protect the vast majority of workers, which is not to say they protect all workers.
Uh-huh.
So almost with any regulation, any what they're called as occupational exposure limits or OELs, any OEL that's on the books now, unfortunately, cannot protect or won't protect 100% of the human population because there are people with chemical sensitivities. In that situation, then the employer really has the responsibility to make a reasonable accommodation for those employees and to recognize that this is a occupationally induced illness and not a psychosomatic illness or mass hysteria or something of that sort. So
the employer had the responsibility in this case. So is there anything else Leslie could have done or...
Well, I was just going to add, I think that one of the challenges that, Leslie, you mentioned, but it's true for workers in a lot of similar situations, is how to demonstrate or document the connection between symptoms that you're feeling and your work. I think it's particularly challenging in the situation that Leslie describes because there's not as much known about it. Sometimes certain people are more sensitive than others. So, you know, I sympathize with the challenge I'm sure Leslie faced, but I'd say in general, that trying to figure out ways to document what you're feeling, which has to do with first, you know, talking to your coworkers and making sure that figuring out a way to find out whether other people are similarly experiencing things, documenting whether things are worse at the end of the day, whether they get better on the weekend. Some of those kinds of things can help begin to point to a work association. Doing the kind of research that I'm sure that Leslie did into the particular exposures that you have and to find out whether or not there are associations between symptoms and those exposures. And it is challenging in the issue of indoor air in a workplace. As Garrett says, a lot of the CalOSHA regulations are not designed to address very low exposures in that kind of circumstance. And so there may be sort of other kind of regulations that are a little bit more broad about the employer having a responsibility to provide a safe work environment. There are some general requirements that can sometimes be brought to bear when there's not a specific regulation that addresses that particular issue. But just to acknowledge, it is challenging and difficult, and I think the situation that Leslie has faced is particularly challenging.
Well, Leslie, I want to thank you very much for your call, and I wish you the best, and I appreciate you providing us with your experience. So let's go right to another caller, and that is a Berkeley caller, Dominica. Dominica, welcome to About Health.
Hi.
Hi.
Calling because I'm actually in a very toxic hospital work environment, and I don't know. I just turned your show program on probably 10 minutes into it, so I wasn't sure if you had covered that. But, I've lost sleep. I, you know, wake up with my boss screaming at me at 2 a.m. with my head, you know.
Why don't you go ahead and discuss the
impact that has on a person's health.
So, Dominica, why don't you go ahead and just tell us about this toxic work environment and hostile work environment you're in?
Well, since I know that the person is currently in a meeting, I know
You don't have to describe. Just if you could just describe the situation without. You don't have to name anybody.
Okay. Well, I'm in a situation where I had started this new job. I had injured my back in the process of moving for this new job, and was there for about 2 months, unable to sit at a desk position, and ended up having to leave after 2 months and because I could no longer walk. So it got to the point where I had to have surgery the first day back after my surgical recovery. She basically screamed at me in front of everybody in the office and then turned around and sent out an email blaming it on me. Apparently, she has everybody in the office terrified, so they're not going to defend me. And I'm basically getting, harassment every day. The environment is such that I feel like a mouse with a cat wandering around. And constantly looking to see if she's in her office, if she's wandering around, if the light's on there. It affects me being able to work. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why somebody as a supervisor would supervise people in that manner, because what it's doing is it's detrimental to your own benefit. No? I mean, mm-hmm. she's keeping me from doing her work for her. And so, I see it as, if I supervise somebody, they're doing my work.
Let's let our guest respond to this. And so we're talking about really sort of more emotionally abusive kind of environment and work situation.
I can start and Garrett can jump in. I think what you're describing relates to what I was saying right at the beginning about how do we think of what a healthy job. Mm-hmm. And often we're thinking, and we have been talking about freedom from exposure from, to hazards on the job, but as we're hearing, some of it is not necessarily physical hazards, but is related to the kind of work environment, as you call it, a toxic work environment where there's lack of respect, where there might be hazard harassment from coworkers or from supervisors, where there might be fear of in the worst case of workplace violence, and these are things that have been documented to lead to high levels of stress and such, and when you have that kind of symptom, that's a work-related symptom that's related to the kind of environment that you work in, and that there needs to be the same kind of attention paid to create reasonable workloads, respectful work conditions, ability to raise issues without being retaliated against. Those are very challenging. It's hard to exercise sort of laws associated with that, though stress is an occupational health illness, and there are circumstances where, you can be eligible for compensation, but it's very limited. So these are difficult. And I know we did work in California about and succeeded in passing a regulation that addresses workplace violence in healthcare. And during the discussions of that regulation, there was a lot of testimony of people who were fearing not only violence, but bullying and other kinds of harassment. And so we heard across the state a lot of really terrible stories similar to the one we're hearing from Dominica. The final standard as it lands is really not addressing those issues, but it did raise the importance of trying to figure out ways to address those issues.
Mm-hmm. And Garrett?
Well, unfortunately, CalOSHA regulations, that's Title 8 of the California Code of Regulations, does not have specific regulations related to hostile work environments per se, along the lines that Dominica is talking out. Although, unfortunately, many inspectors like myself encounter that both in offices and also in manufacturing facilities and agricultural workforces as well. There are regulations related to one of the things she was talking about, which is the lack of an ergonomically designed workstation. So that is a requirement that the employers have, that to provide workstations that are designed for the person who's using and doing the work rather than vice versa, as we were talking about earlier.
And is that based on the size of the office? Garrett?
No, absolutely not. Here in California, the Title VIII regulations apply to every employer who has one or more employee. The only person that is not covered by California's health and safety, workplace health and safety regulations are self-employed people that don't employ anyone else.
Well, Dominic, I want to thank you for calling in, and I wish you the best with this employer, and I hope things turn around for you there. Thanks again. If you are just tuning in, you're listening to About Health, and I'm Dr. Will Courtney, your host. Today is International Workers' Day, or May Day, and in commemoration of the day, we're talking about workers' safety and health. We'd love to hear your questions or comments. Have you been asked to do things for work that you feel have put your safety at risk? Are there substances that you use in your workplace that you're afraid may cause you harm? And what about your workstation? Have your employers made it ergonomically healthy? Give us a call at 510-848-4425. That's 848-4425. Or in the 800 number, 958-9008. 1-800-958-9008. Joining me in studio today are two experts in occupational health and safety. Laura Stock is the director of the Labor Occupational Health Program at the University of California, Berkeley. Garrett Brown is an occupational health and safety professional who conducted workplace health and safety inspections for Cal OSHA for nearly 20 years. If you have questions for our guests, we'd love to hear from you. So again, call us at 510-848-4425 or toll free at 1-800-958-9008. And Garrett and Laura, I think I'm just going to go to something that a listener wrote into me about, and this is really gets to sort of what can people do about, you know, if they're in a situation that they feel is not healthy. And this fellow is employed by a major Bay Area furniture retailer. And here's what he wrote to me. I work in an open warehouse and loading dock. In a corner of this open warehouse, workers spray lacquer and sealants on wood furniture. The warehouse isn't designed for this, so there isn't a contained room for it and no exhaust vents that draw out fumes. So all of the workers in the warehouse are exposed to these chemicals. These are heavy chemicals that when you breathe them in, they knock you over and make you dizzy. I've gone to my managers about this and talked with the human resources person. They don't do anything to fix it. But what they have done is told employees not to wear masks so others don't think there's anything dangerous they're breathing in. We've also been told not to do any spraying when bosses are visiting the warehouse. The fire marshal comes through the warehouse regularly, but only checks for things like exits. The fire marshal has never asked about spraying of chemicals. So, what do we say to this listener who's got quite a terrible situation here at work?
Right. Well, and unfortunately, I during the course of, you know, two decades of inspections, saw many things like that. Auto shops, for example, another area where you have airborne spraying of liquids such as paints or lacquers or sealants. The situation you described actually is in violation of probably half a dozen Cal OSHA regulations. So what's occurring there is actually in violation of state law. The question is how to go about giving that to end or have that work being done in a way that's compliant with the state regulations. If he's brought it to the attention of his employer and the employer has been unresponsive to it, I'm assuming it's probably not a union situation. Unfortunately, in the United States today, in the private sector, only 7% of workers have a union. So 93% of workers do not have a union at all, and need, are in a situation where they can't defend themselves if there's a level of reprisals or discriminations against people there. But in that situation, workers always have a right to file an anonymous complaint with Cal OSHA. And the way that you do that is simply to pick up the phone and call the nearest Cal OSHA district office, compliance enforcement office. There are 18 of them around the state, and of course we have numbers here that can, if there are callers that need those numbers, or they can just go to the website. They're all posted at the Cal OSHA website.
And that's cal-osha.org.
No,
is that right?
No, that actually is the Cal OSHA reporter.
Okay.
Yeah, no, just Google it. Just Google Cal OSHA, or the California Division of Occupational Safety and Health.
Uh-huh.
And that'll take you right to it.
So, and what are the implications, Garrett, of somebody going to Cal OSHA? So is this, I'm assuming they can do this anonymously, or?
That's correct. Yeah, no, we take worker complaints, and they can be anonymous. In the real world, people have to realize that if they're the only one in the workplace who's complaining about something, uh-huh. and they raised it with the boss, and all of a sudden here comes a compliance inspection from Cal OSHA, that they're may well be some reprisals or discrimination, which is itself completely illegal.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a sister agency of Cal OSHA called the Labor Commissioner's Office that has a division that investigates retaliation and discrimination, which are all illegal reprisals against employees. Another way to do it, though, oftentimes frankly found that the threat of a Cal OSHA inspection is oftentimes as effective as an actual inspection.
Mm-hmm.
So I've known of cases where workers, oftentimes collectively, because sometimes it's better to work collectively with your coworkers than by yourself, have, you know, signed a petition or gone to the boss's office together, or simply said, you know, unless this situation is resolved, we're going to have no alternative but to call Cal OSHA. Mm-hmm. And frequently that actually works. So there are a variety of ways to bring the situation, hopefully, to a successful conclusion. It all depends on the specifics of, you know, of the workplace and what people feel will be the consequences.
And what about the fire marshal? Can there be a way of enlisting the fire marshal or tipping them off to what's happening?
Absolutely. I mean, uncontrolled or airborne, open air spraying of flammable substances is a violation of the fire code. And if this is in, say, the Bay Area, where we've just had these terrible warehouse fires, the Ghost Ship in mm-hmm. Oakland and elsewhere, I think the fire marshals in the Bay Area are particularly sensitive at this moment to fire hazards.
Mm-hmm. And Laura Stock, you want
to respond? Yeah, just to add to that, I do think calling Cal OSHA is an important right and a tool to have in your toolbox, so to speak. But it's not necessarily, I would say, the very first place to go, except under circumstances where you're facing an imminent hazard and threat to life and limb. But for an ongoing hazard, you're going to have a greater success of getting Cal OSHA, as Garrett said, if you do some homework in advance, including they're going to be looking to, for example, to have about whether or not you have tried to raise the issue prior to calling them. And it seems, you know, it's very useful to do your own work, to document what you're experiencing. As I said earlier, the more you can work collectively with your coworkers, the more you can start to survey people to document whether the hazard exposure that you're experiencing is experienced by everyone, and begin to actually create, you know, collect data that you can then present to both your employer, and then if your employer does not respond, to Cal OSHA. I mean, there's a lot of workers who are very vulnerable in the workplace, and this issue of how to take action is a very important mm-hmm. one, and it's important for us to recognize what was possible and what isn't possible for people, keeping in mind that vulnerability. And so that's why talking to people as a group, not singling yourself out if possible, engaging with either a community-based organization or a union if you have it, to help strategize about the best way to talk to the employer. And then if all of that fails, to go to Cal OSHA. And it is important to say that Cal OSHA is very under-resourced in California, that they have, you know, not enough inspectors to go to every workplace. And that's been an ongoing challenge. So, again, where you can work together with your employer in partnership with a union or a community organization to try to make changes within the workplace, you might get a faster result. But that, on the other hand, if those things don't work, and again, if you're facing a really important and imminent hazard, then, of course, you need to be immediately getting the help that you need, and including going to Cal OSHA if you need to.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, let's go to another caller. Let's talk to Steve, who's calling us from Alexander Valley. Hello, Steve. Welcome to About Health.
Hi. I was listening to your program, I often do, and your previous caller, Dominica, or whatever her name is.
Yes, Dominica.
I'm getting that right.
Mm-hmm.
with regards to workplace harassment and other things like that, I worked for a public agency for 34 years. I'm retired now, but I noticed that you touched on it briefly a moment ago, but the importance of document. Instances, occurrences, these things require documentation. Without documentation, times, instances of what happened, what was said, you have nothing to work with. And I think it's an important facet in all these things.
And is that a strategy that you've needed to resort to, Steve?
I have done it and then not be required to use it. I was in a supervisory capacity, and I advised my employees when they saw things happening around them or to them that were inappropriate. It's the best way to not stand up in front of a bunch of people and have no facts. And it's just something you're touching on lightly, but it is very important in most workplaces to have a record of what has happened.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Steve, for the call, and thanks for emphasizing that point. Laura or Garrett, do you want to add anything to that?
I completely agree. Uh-huh. I think that is essential, both to document your own experience, to document the hazard where you can do your own research, to talk to coworkers and capture examples of where other people have experienced similar things is really essential.
Uh-huh. Okay, well then let's go to another caller, and that would be you, Lisa, in Oakland. Welcome to About Health.
Hi, can you hear me?
We can. Welcome to About Health.
Yeah, thank you very much for doing this subject. I want to talk about two things. Common usage of common products like varnish on a floor in commercial workplaces. And for instance, at KPFA, there was a floor that was varnished on an interior room that had no ventilation. And it caused me and my guests a lot of pain in my lungs. And, you know, when you look at the ingredients on the varnish, just regular varnish, it says very dangerous and cancer-causing, and et cetera. And when I complained to the management, they didn't seem to be aware of any issues, even though I called OSHA. And according to OSHA, you have to give notice and have ventilation. Since then, I've gotten very bad asthma. So I guess I'm wondering two things. Talk a little bit about common varnishes, why progressive organizations like KPFA may be unaware of these and are not instituting non-toxic practices. And three, apparently the legal standing of a guest or an unpaid staff member is not the same as a paid worker in filing a complaint with OSHA. So if you could address those three factors, I appreciate it.
Okay. Well, thanks, Lisa. I'm sorry to hear that happened here, and sounds like we should have had Garrett and Laura on here sooner. But do you want to address these concerns of Lisa?
Sure. No, I think she did a pretty good job of explaining what's required. There is a standard in California called the Hazard Communication Standard, which requires the employer to inform employees of their actual or future or potential exposures to chemical agents, what the health hazards are and what actions need to be taken to protect people's health. So it's common, unfortunately, in painting in office buildings, for example, as kind of a knucklehead move on the part of the owner or the developer, that they want to literally paint around people that are working in an office. And clearly this is not going to be a productive work environment, let alone a safe one. So hazard communication, notification of employees is very important. Secondly, ventilation. Ventilation is required because, as I mentioned earlier, there are exposure limits. How much of an airborne concentration of any given substance is allowable under the law? And as we were speaking earlier, those levels may not protect everyone, but by and large will protect most people. So the two issues that she raised are exactly correct, that has common and ventilation. And on the issue of guests, Cal OSHA has a only has jurisdiction when there's an employee-employer relationship. So someone who works for KPFA can file a complaint, or we have jurisdiction to whatever hazard the management of KPFA either did or failed to do with regard to its own employees. Guests, however, like the general public, and we don't have jurisdiction in most cases. There are specific circumstances where we've been able to do that in the past, but it's more because the guests are sort of representatives or stand-ins for actual employees. But that's also true, as our caller Lisa pointed out.
Well, Lisa, thank you very much for phoning in. I appreciate those questions. And if you are just tuning in, by any chance, you're listening to About Health, and we're talking today on May Day about worker safety and health, and we'd love to hear from you. Our number is 510-848-4425, or toll-free 800-958-9008. Let me ask the two of you about consumers, people who hire workers to repair the roof or do yard work, clean out an attic. What responsibilities do consumers have when they hire these workers?
Well, it's very important that you, if you're a homeowner, for example, that you only hire people that have a contractor's license and workers' compensation. The reason being is if you hire somebody as a favor even, or somebody's brother or cousin who is not covered by workers' compensation, and they fall off the ladder while they are fixing your roof, you, the homeowner, since you hired them, are responsible for whatever medical care they may need, which these days could be considerable.
Wow.
So it's very important in most situations for homeowners to hire, you know, licensed contractors that have workers' compensation.
Wow. So I would venture to guess that none of our listeners who's had somebody come and, you know, clean their yard, you know, or do their, mow their lawn, or, you know, fix something around the house, but, you know, smaller kinds of things, would even think to ask if they have workers' compensation.
Right. Well, I mean, I can use myself. I mean, I've gone to Home Depot and gotten a couple of guys who are standing in the parking lot to help with yard work, which is probably not the best idea, but with yard work, it's not very hazardous. They're pulling weeds. They're helping me pull out bushes and the like for 3 hours on a Saturday afternoon. I would never think of going to the Home Depot parking lot to get house painters, for example, who are people that are going to be up on ladders and could fall off easily and would have, you know, tens of thousands of dollars worth of you know, hospital bills, should it be. So, I mean, to a certain extent, you know, you have to think. Actually, I think the law is if you, it's a contract greater than $500. So in theory, I'm, as generous as I may be, I'm not paying yard workers $500 for 3 hours work on a Saturday afternoon. But again, the key thing is you want workers to be part of a work organization that has the structure, knows its responsibilities to safeguard the health and safety of its employees. You don't want them to be part of a fly-by-night operation where people are going to get hurt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I would add, I mean, you sort of mentioned consumers. Right now we're talking about employers. If you're going to be an employer when you hire someone, you know, that then all of the things that we're talking about are questions you need to ask yourself. You know, what, you know, obviously, are you complying with the labor law? Are you providing workers' comp if you need to? Are you ensuring that the conditions that you're providing are healthy? If you're hiring somebody to be a domestic worker, are you providing chemicals that are safe to use? Are you providing equipment that's safe to use? Are you providing a predictable schedule? Because that's been a big issue now, that people don't have predictable schedules, and it's an important element of a healthy job. So, you know, it's important for employers to ask themselves those questions and to really feel comfortable that they are providing safe and healthy jobs. I think as a consumer, it's beyond that. It's just something that I feel like, since I've been in the field, my my thinking has changed, and we all need to be thinking when we go to a restaurant or if we stay in a hotel, thinking about the working conditions faced by the people who are working there. Are there ways you can make your voice as a consumer be raised to encourage employers to treat the workers that you're benefiting from whether it's people who serve you in a restaurant or clean your room in a hotel, whether you're contributing to the effort to try to make those jobs safe? Just something to begin to, you know, all of us should be thinking as we go through our lives.
And but how can we assess that? You go into a hotel, I mean, how can you really assess?
Well, you know, that's a good question about whether or not there are ways that if you want to know, am I going to a hotel that is known for providing decent working conditions? Mm-hmm. I mean, there's sort of broad questions you might ask. Is that hotel represented by a union, for example? So certainly the union that's representing Hotel Housekeepers Unite Here have really embraced the importance of trying to create good working conditions for housekeepers, and in fact, have been behind a proposed Kalosha regulation that would improve working conditions for that group of workers, and so that might be one question you might be able to ask. And I think also just even as we go, if we have opportunities to talk to managers or supervisors, to have that be a question that we might ask: Are people being treated decently? I know that there have been some campaigns around restaurants of various community-based organizations that are trying to raise awareness of the conditions that people face in restaurants, and there's actually apps that have been created that you can identify restaurants that are taking pledges to provide decent working conditions.
Yeah.
And there's similar kinds of campaigns around produce, about being able to label the produce that you buy, whether they are being grown under equitable conditions. So there are a range of organizations and campaigns that have been trying to make it easier for consumers to identify places to patronize that are providing decent working conditions.
Oh, that's great to know about. Are there any particular apps that you know offhand?
I know that there's an organization called ROC, ROC, Restaurants Opportunities
Center
that have been focusing on trying to highlight working conditions in restaurants, and have created an app. So probably if you do a Google search for ROC, you'll come across some of those resources.
Uh-huh, that sounds great. Well, let's go to another caller. Let's talk to Greg, who's calling us from San Francisco. Greg, welcome to About Health.
Thank you very much. I think what I'm going to speak about is kind of tied in with the previous caller talked about. I'm kind of semi-retired, but I've had some real, some real experiences with jobs. When I'll give you an example. I had, for example, I had two jobs where in those days you had like a 90-day temporary employment kind of law where you had 90 days to kind of prove yourself and then would become permanent employment. Well, I noticed that the first job I had like that, man, they just worked us to death. And, I'm doing everything I can. And on the 89th day, they told me that, hey, it's not working out. And I said, well, what did I do wrong? And they said, well, it's just not working out. Well, tell me, because whatever I did wrong, I don't want it to happen again. And, it crushed me. And, plus they're working you really hard and you're in all these dangerous conditions. And you're wondering, like, just let you go like that. And then it happened again, and then I figured out what it was they just work you to death and then let you go, and then they don't have to give you full benefits, that kind of thing. And then on another job I had, I was a driver, and I'm from the Midwest, and I just moved to the Bay Area. And I was supposed to drive all throughout the Bay Area. I'm talking about everywhere from Oakland, San Francisco, South Bay, everywhere. I wasn't that familiar with it. They stick a map in your hand and tell you to, like, deliver all these things, and you're on a time limit, and you don't really know where you're going. You don't have any previous training, and they just throw you right in the fire like that. You up and down 880 with all this heavy traffic. See, these things that I'm explaining to you, they can be psychologically as well as physically damaging because all the stress and the physical part involved. And then also, another job I had, I was working with a guy that his job was to I guess it was connected to the city. His job was to, when somebody died and they had lived in a house a long time, when the family, when the family members took everything they wanted from the house, his job was to come in and clean out the rest of the house so it could be ready for sale, real estate-wise. Well, one day, this guy had me working in a job where a lady had died, all right? She had, like, an enormous amount of cats. And the cats, well, you know, this might be a little bit too graphic, but when she died, there was nobody there to help her. The cats literally ate her face. And then the place was, we had to go clean up the mess, and the cats had, you know, defecated for, like, months and months, maybe years. Well, you know, at least for 2 or 3 weeks, a month or so. And we had to wear hazmat suits, and I didn't know the thing. I didn't know what was going on. But when we entered the street right in front of the house, you could smell the odor coming out of that. So the point I'm trying to make, I was going into those kind of horrific conditions, and I think that it should be some kind of law against putting people in situations where you're getting exploited like that. And, disused and put in dangerous situations, health-wise as well as psychologically.
Yeah, no, and, Greg, you made those points, very clearly with those stories.
Yeah, in fact, there is a law. Everything he's described is actually against existing California law. One of the great things about Cal OSHA, two great things is that it doesn't matter whether you're on probation or not. The moment you start working for somebody, you're covered. The other great thing about Cal OSHA is we don't care whether people have papers or don't have papers to be in the United States. It's totally irrelevant to Cal OSHA.
Oh, that's...
If you're here, you're working in California. Workers in California have rights totally regardless of their immigration status.
Great. Well, that's good. That's really important to know. And, Greg, I want to thank you again for that call and for sharing those stories with us. And we are once again at the end of the show, and I'm sorry to those of you who phoned in whose calls we couldn't get to. If you'd like to learn more about the work of the Labor Occupational Health Program at UC Berkeley, you can visit their website at lohp.org, lohp.org. And if you, and I gave out the incorrect Cal OSHA website, but you can locate them online, and you can get reports on workers' health there. If you want to file a complaint, you can do that. If you're an employer and you want to consult with somebody, one of the Cal OSHA folks about something you're concerned about, you can get consultation from them as well. So I want to thank you, Laura Stock and Garrett Brown, very much for joining us today. It's been a pleasure talking with you. I also want to thank you, our listeners, for joining us, and especially those of you who phoned in. Thanks also to our board operator, Lucretia Burton. If you want to hear any of today's program that you missed, or you'd like to listen to past shows, you can find the podcast at kpfa.org on the About Health page. And if you have suggestions for future shows or guests, you are welcome to contact me, Dr. Will, at themensdoc.com. That's themensdoc.com. And you can also contact me there if you want to learn more about my psychotherapy services. You can also reach me at themensdoc.com. So I want to wish you all very good health from all of us at About Health.
Africa Today and Transitions on Traditions on Monday, September 11th, as we honor the life and legacy of Damir Kalata Ahmad. Damir served our communities faithfully, in the rebellions and resistance of the 1960s, with the Black Panther Party, in the Oakland School District, in education, in the mosque, and in our communities. Damira supported our political prisoners, our youth, our families, and committed her life to service for us. Listen to the voices of friends, family, and comrades as we honor Damira Ahmad. Join us, a celebration of Damira Carlotta Ahmad on KPFA 94.1 FM on Monday, September 11th, between 7 and 10 p.m. Ashe.
David K. Johnson is the New York Times reporter, a Pulitzer Prize winner, who wrote the recent biography, The Making of Donald Trump. He is now following that with the compelling, disquieting, What Donald Trump is Doing to You. Drawing on 30 years of closely studying his subject, Johnson promises to disclose Trump's actual impact on our lives. Hosted by Brian Edwards Tiekert of KPFA's Discerning Upfront Show, Johnson will be here Thursday, October 19th, 7:30 p.m. at First Congregational Church, 2345 Channing Way in Berkeley. Wheelchair accessible, this KPFA benefit might remind you to renew your passport. Tickets available at brownpapertickets.com and the customary independent bookstores. October 19th. Tell friends.
And this is 94.1 KPFA.